Hey, welcome back to Turntable Guy. On the bench today, we have a real lovely piece of junk. Actually, it's not that bad. I have been looking for a little, well, quote-unquote, Discman, right? Just because, you know, cars don't come with CD players anymore. I mean, someone wouldn't even come with an auxiliary input anymore, so this may be a exercise in futility. But I was just looking for a little disc player that I can plug into the, my one vehicle does have an aux port, it doesn't have a CD player, so I thought, maybe something like this will work, I've been looking for a little while. I saw an early Sony's real Discman, and it was all metal, it was really nice, but without power and batteries, it's hard to obviously test it to see if it's working. And more likely than not, they are not working. These weren't the most reliable units. Maybe the Sony's are better, but you can't test it. And the nasty thing about that Sony was the AC adapter power inlet was a negative center. So you can't just plug in any regular style AC adapter. Most are positive center, but the Sony was a negative center. So that was really irritating. So I had to leave it. And so I've been looking for the last few weeks for something, and this one, I found this one today. There were three on the shelf, and this one seemed to work. There was no power adapter, so what you have to do in that situation is you gotta you go to like the phone section where the cordless phones are, and usually people when they drop off their phones, they tend to drop off with the power adapter. So that's a great place to just plug in and see if you can find something that fits. And this came off a phone. What is this? It doesn't even say. But anyway, you know, I had a quick peek. This is, it says right on here, it is positive center. And it's two batteries, but I think the input voltage is 4.5. Oh, there it is right there. DC in, oh, six volts. So, and this thing was 6 volts, I believe. Yeah, 6 volts, 400 milliamps. So I'm like, this'll work. And luckily, when I plugged it in, it fit perfect. So anyway, I just kind of left it on there, went and paid, and away we go. But one thing I did notice while I was there is that when I opened up this battery case here, these batteries were on the shelf. I tested to see if they worked, but the batteries that were in here, these are not the batteries that were in it. They were left in there, and we've got some battery rot here. Come on, it's really hard to get out. I did get it out at the store. There we go. Yeah, we've got classic, you know, battery corrosion in there, as you can see. Probably worn out the connector as well. So that's going to have to be dealt with. Shake that out. But I was able to plug it in, which is great. And I was able to verify that it's reading a disc and that it's playing. So that's a good thing. So I have no desire to fix this. But what we're going to do is, what's this, bass boost on, off. Yeah, what we're going to do is we're going to give it a service and see exactly, you know, what's in here. We'll have a peek around, and we'll clean out that battery thing, and then we'll give it a sound test, and we'll give it a nice cleaning, and then we'll put it into service. And yes, I did pay $11 for it, but I had a coupon because I just dumped off a whole bunch of crap from the house, so I got, I think, $3 off or something. So anyway, so that's... that's this lovely Memorex. So Memorex, as many of you may remember, was a cassette tape maker. And I'm sure the name, I think it was an American company originally, and then I'm sure it got bought by somebody at some point. And, you know, eventually I'm sure it got into the hands of some third party or Chinese company, which started using the brand name on electronics. Yeah, it's made in China. So I don't think we're going to have anything special here. But I do like this one because it does have the 20-second buffer, which is nice. And it's built well. It's a softer plastic, which is nice. so it's not going to crack, and it's got these big heavy clamps there that clamp down on the desk, so it shouldn't open. So anyway, but we're going to open it, and we're going to have a peek inside. I'll clean the laser, lubricate the rails if necessary, and go from there. I'm sure this thing has tiny, tiny screws. That's the display and buttons up here. They were working okay. And I'm just wondering how the power, the display, gets over here. Because here's our display, and oh, maybe not. Oh, no, this is nothing. This is absolutely nothing. There is actually, these buttons don't do, there's nothing here on the lid. All the buttons are here. Ah, okay. So this is absolutely no electronics in here. So we can just remove that probably and clean it. Here's our hinge. Take that off. We'll take this off to clean it. We'll take off this rubber gasket. I think we have to remove these screws first. So we're talking really tiny screws here. So you're going to need your jeweler screwdriver. And some good powered glasses, unless you're very young, with great eyes. And you definitely want to put these screws in some kind of container, because they will go missing very quickly. So that's kind of a really wimpy hinge. Okay, that's not the only part of the hinge. There's more here. Okay, all right, that's good to see. So we'll take those two off. We'll magnetize our screwdriver. And then, yeah, there's two screws over here. Okay. All right, that's better. All right, there we go. There's our lid. So now we can give that a good cleaning. Take off this rubber gasket. Set that aside. I think we'll continue to disassemble it here. We'll remove these four screws. Okay, so that's all part of that. This is probably stuck on. Yeah, we'll leave that there. And this is all part of it. You could remove this metal here, but I don't think that's worth it. And what we'll do is we'll take this to the sink and we'll give it a good cleaning with a toothbrush and a degreaser. So now we're going to get inside here. Does this come out? Sure will eventually. What I want to get out of here, I want to be able to remove these battery terminals to clean those. But first, we're going to remove screws here, and there's arrows. 1, 2, 3, and 4, it says. Let's do those. That one's not coming up. That one did. stripped. I don't know what's going on with that one. That's not good. Oh, it just came right out. It's not even grabbing. All right, let's see if we can pry this up. I'm going to go on this side. There's a open door and closed door switch here. Feeling the screw is not coming out at all, and it's holding it down. That's better. Almost there. Oh, there's one more. That would have been ugly, eh? So there's five screws holding it down. Come on. There we go. Very nice. Oh, look, there's capacitors too. Wash that, and we can get out our. Here's that hinge that goes in there. We'll just leave that there, and yeah, look at this, eh? Oh, neat. These CD mechanisms on three rubber mounts here to keep it kind of shock absorbed. We got all sorts of smaller style capacitors here. Lots of cheap brands. Caps on SI brand. Oh, yeah. Interesting. What's this do? Well, it's volume control. So that can be deoxided. And we'll clean these switches with a little bit of contact cleaner. Just get a little bit of shot of neutral. Whoops. Yeah, you're always going to overspray. And then just work them. Just like that. You can pull up the laser mech here. It looks like it's stuck down to the board. Let's remove it. Let's unstick it from the board without damaging anything. And they're using some kind of two-sided tape here. It's really annoying. Okay, so there's our laser mech, and we've got three plugs for it, and they're all color-coded here. Blue, white, and red. Just like the French flag. And here is our board. Is this fastened at all to the... It's not screwed down. Oh, maybe it is. What's that there? Hold. What does hold mean? We'll switch in there. It says hold. Not sure exactly what's holding it down. Could be these two battery posts are holding it down. And it doesn't help that I've got the power thing still in there. Maybe it'll come up now. Wants to come up. Definitely wants to come up. Yeah, I think I just got to keep prying at this. That'll give me an opportunity to hopefully clean these correctly. Yes. Excellent. There's our board. And here is our case. Nice. All right, so that's pretty easy to disassemble, and looks like it's going to be pretty easy to service. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these over to the sink, and I'm going to give these a nice wash, clean them all up, and all three pieces, the lid, the cover here, the board cover, and the base. We'll get these all nice and clean. And I shall return. Okay, we've got everything ripped apart here. I got the oil here because we're going to service the motor on the transport. We'll do that next. Just to give you an idea, this is the bottom here. These are where the two battery terminals go down. Clean that off. You still get a little bit of battery crud in here. Sometimes you got to scrape that stuff off. It's no big deal. It doesn't affect plastic. The main thing is that I got in on the main board here and I gave the battery terminals a good cleaning and sanding. Gave them a cleaning with a little bit of a contact cleaner and sanded down the contact areas. So batteries are going to get a good connection now. So yeah, that's it. So let's service our transport. You want to be careful with this cable. It's very delicate. Let's zoom in. I think there's a lot to do here. Okay, first of all, if we turn it over, here's a couple motors. This is the disc spinning motor. Okay, you can put a couple drops of oil in those two little holes there to get the bottom bearing. There's not enough space here to get at the top bearing. It's spinning okay, so I don't think it's an issue with lubrication on this one whatsoever. So we're just going to leave that. What I do want to lubricate is the motor. Now, this is the drive motor, and if you turn it this way, You can see inside here how there's a little gear. And you can definitely get your oiler underneath there to give this motor a little bit of oil. So we want to just put one drop right underneath that spot there. And you can just spin this little gear here to get the oil to go down. So that's lubed. As far as this worm gear is concerned, I don't think it really needs any lubrication. We can put a little drop of oil there. It wouldn't hurt anything. Maybe just where the gears touch there, and then just maybe just spin it a little bit like that, just to distribute it a little bit. And that's pretty much it for lube. These are the two little oiling holes right here. They should get you into that bottom bearing. Now, here's my favorite part. The old controversial CD player lens. Get a lot of people telling you what to do with a CD player lens. And I will continue to do what I've done in the past and what we used to do when I worked in the electronics store. And that is to use just a dab of window cleaner and to clean the laser with that. This one looks pretty clean anyway. So you just want to gently clean off the top. Now, a Discman style compact disc player like this will probably have a little bit more of a dirtier lens because it's open and you can definitely get your hands in there and you could touch it by mistake, right? So then turn it around, use the dry side and give that a clean. And that is our service. Okay, so we're going to put this back. So the trick here is to get your battery terminals into these two slots, just like that, while getting the various switches and slots and all that kind of thing, like headphone jack and all that stuff, into their appropriate holes. I think I got that one wrong. I think it might be better to get the, put your headphone jacks and stuff in first, and then slide in your contacts, battery contacts here. There we go. Okay. And I will put our transport back on. Now there is that kind of sticky stuff here. We're going to get this cable in first. We'll just make sure that this is open. That. Get this connected. We're doing that, sliding it back, and then getting the transport into position. And that sticky glue will hold that wire down. And we'll get these back into their little pegs here. which is there. So that should move now. Okay. And we have three wires. Again, they're color-coded, so should be no problem getting these back. We got blue. And then our white. And then our red. So those are all our electrical connections. Just done a basic reassembly here, and as you can see, it is running. Let's pause. Let's play. Audio. Let's get some audio. Audio output. It's working. There must be something to do with that switch in the back. Unplug it. I just got it, kind of got it just thrown together for now. But I can confirm it's still working. So I think that's it for cleaning and the electronics. Obviously, we're not going to recap this. Could check to see if batteries are working, but I don't know if I have any batteries that are actually having power. Let me out here. 1.5, that'll do. 1.5, they'll do. All right, let's see if our batteries are working. It's kind of loosey-goosey. I could probably come out a little bit. That's better. All right. This was the power button. Yeah, there we go. We definitely have power. That's the off button. Let's just put a disc on here just for fun. It should spin up. We turn it on. Let's see here. Oh, it won't go if this switch here isn't down, I don't think. Definitely wants to go, but anyway, it definitely is working with the power adapter, which is good. Let's put this thing back together correctly. Let me do that, and look, just to show you how it turned out as far as cleaning. I just gave it a good wash in the sink, just with some glass cleaner this time, and a little toothbrush just to get rid of the marks and stuff. And then I'm going to give this an exterior polish as well, just to get rid of some of these scratches and stuff. So let me stop. I'll get it back together and we'll give it a final test. Okay, what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to apply a little bit of plastic polish on the center logo here and maybe a little bit on the glass. I don't want to polish around here too much because this writing looks like it's going to flake off if I put any kind of abrasive on it. So we'll just use a little bit of Plastex, and we'll just Do that little cleaning here. And we'll go over it with a microfiber. That cleans it up nicely. And then a little shot on this glass. It's quite scratched. You're not going to get out the deep scratches with this stuff, but you don't need a lot for this little glass here. Just want to give that a little cleaning. And that looks a million times better. That's great. I think that's it. I think that's all we're going to do with this one. Let's plug it back in. And we'll give it a final test. Got our audio cable hooked up. Power. Laser's moved back to the top position here. You know, it helps if you plug stuff in. It really does. There we go. Skips through, no problem. Maybe a little slow to access. It gets there. So, if we shake this thing without the anti-shock, which is the buffer, let's see how bad it is. Okay, it's bad. So let's put the anti-shock on now. So now it's going to do like a 20 second buffer. So you got to give it a few seconds to buffer. All right, let's try now. There we go, see? So there you go. There's the Memorex. Does this thing have a model number? It does. M2D8024. Kind of like a Discman. Is it worth anything? Yeah, I think it's worth the $7 or $8 I paid for it. It's not a bad little unit. Sounds fine. And like I've said, it's a CD player. Of course it sounds good. I mean, unless we're talking about a real piece of crap, a decent DAC is going to be a decent DAC, right? And it's pretty hard to find a horrible DAC. That's what I think anyway. Let's see if this plays. Fires right up, plays, sounds good. So mode. I'm not sure what mode does. Oh, it's like a repeat. Repeat all, repeat track. Okay. Random. It's got a memory on it. There's your anti-shock feature. Skip up, skip down, and away we go. There you go. One El Cheapo Chinese Discman. Not as bad as it looks, but I think it's going to come in handy. It's definitely going to work fine in the car. Hook it up with the auxiliary output to the aux in and on your head unit in your car. And, for those of you who don't have a disc player anymore, perfect opportunity to bring all your 3,000 discs into your car again. Remember those days when you had all those folders and stuff and you'd have to go rifling through those to pull out a disc? Miss those days, don't you? Yeah, exactly. Okay, thanks guys. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed this one. It's a little bit odd. Hopefully you get we're gonna get that Hitachi back on the bench. The one that I'm doing the restoration of, the HT1, I believe. We did part one, so we're gonna do part two, which is a cleaning. That should be coming up next. Catch you next one. Bye.